Good afternoon and welcome back to Laurel Park. Thank you for joining us on this Sunday Fun Day edition of Today at the Races. I'm Gabby Gaudette, joined by Stan Salter. Stan, how are you feeling the day after Maryland Million?
Doing well. Maryland's Day at the Races lived up to the hype and the billing as it always did, as it always does. It was the 31st running of the Jim McKay Maryland Million. We saw some nice long shots. We saw a repeat winner in the Maryland Million Classic. We saw the handle grow from last year up 18.5%, nice handle, almost a little shy of 4.5 million, and that's up 59% from the 2014 handle. The joint was packed yesterday. Looked like everybody was having a great time, and it was a lot of fun working with you and Acacia all day long.
I echo that as well, and attendance was up. We just had, and I would say morale was up, but everybody really excited about all of the renovations, improvements, and the state of Maryland breeding, racing, just the whole big picture. Everybody really excited, and we'll get to a highlight of yesterday's card, and we'll start things off with the Maryland Million Turf. And we saw, we'll go back and watch the stretch run of Flash Phelps coming back and keeping his title in the Maryland Million Turf. And Victor Carrasco saying in the post-stakes interview he knew he was on much the best, just kind of stayed out in the clear and had a confident hand ride home. He's really turned into quite a remarkable horse, and even Ronnie Jenkins getting a little emotional after the race too.
Yeah, he's a cool horse, workmanlike fashion there, winning the race for the second year in a row. Just keeps getting better and better. He could be even better as a 6 and 7 year old. He's the fan favorite in the barn. Everybody loves the horse, and great to see the owner, Mrs. Charles, here yesterday. The groom too, congratulations to the groom, Tony of Flash Elves. He won the groom's award.
He did. There were groom's awards throughout the afternoon. We'll get to the yesterday's headliner though, and that was the Maryland Million Classic. And I felt like we were back in 2015 watching the same thing all over again, as we saw Admiral's War Chest and a very savvy ride by Taylor Hole go to the front end and never look back. It's funny, you see this horse, he is a huge, huge animal. He doesn't look like he would be that fast, but he sure is.
Yeah, Taylor Hole, a veteran jockey here. He's been around for a long time. He's won a bunch of races. He was on the defending champ with Lone Speed. When they let him get away with the early quarter, almost 25, I said, well, this looks like it might be over. Then it looked like they made him quicken up a little bit the second quarter. So I was saying, well, maybe he'll come back a little bit. But he was a confident ride there. Congratulations to all the connections of a two-time Maryland Million Classic winner, Admiral's War Chest. I think first time it's been done since Ain't Too Fast to Catch, I believe.
Absolutely, yes. So congratulations to them. Congratulations to everybody for having an excellent day. And we want to thank everybody on the other side of things. You know, you and I and Acacia, we're working in front of the camera, but everyone behind the scenes too. Hats off to them for a great day. We get to today though, and boy, what a card it is. This is a difficult card, but betting opportunities galore. And we want to take this time to remind everybody that this is the final week of that Players Challenge to qualify. Again, that's $5,000 guaranteed in that championship, but this is the final week to qualify, Stan. So, you know, we're going to try to go out with a bang here.
Yeah, and we need to get qualified too. We both get a promotional pick, but I'm gonna go in for the second pick as well, because I just missed last Sunday. I missed by 20 cents. Hammy Smith beat me beat me out of the last spot last Sunday. So, trying to get qualified for next Sunday, the championship round, the $5,000 championship round. That'll be a nice Sunday fun day here at Laurel. And don't forget about the Premier Parlay, where you can pick, you like any football games today? We need to get a three-team parlay going so you can double your Premier player points.
I have to go and make sure I know who's playing today. I'm still in Maryland Million mode, so I will be taking part in that, and as will you, Stan. But
and they can watch all the games, the NFL Sunday Ticket, in that new bar on the second floor of the clubhouse, the new football sports bar. I think we're still coming up with the official name, but we were all up there after the races last night. What a cool bar that is up there. If I was coming out here on a Sunday to bet the races and watch football, that's where I'd be hanging out.
And guess what? I've got an early daily double. It's got bourbon all over it. We'll get to that in just a little bit. But first, Let's get to those carryovers. We have carryovers galore the day after Maryland Million Day. We had a beautiful handle yesterday, too. Again, up 18.5% from last year. So nice carryovers. Rolling Super High Five starts in the first race, over $5,500. And that, the Rainbow Six, does start later on this afternoon in race six. That is $2,360 and change. And the Late Pick Five, a whopping $19,000. So I know you and I are going to go in on a ticket. We can't, that's just, you know, just dangling bait in front of us. We got to dive in on that carryover.
And I'm predicting there'll be at least around 30,000 new money, be my guess, on a big day. So Late Pick Five pull expected. Hopefully you get up around 50,000 or more. So tough sequence. You have to have your handicap and shoes on and go deep and come up with some prices, because most likely there'll be some prices in that Late Pick Five.
Let's get to the track and weather conditions. It is a glorious fall afternoon. It was a bit blustery yesterday, but the winds have died down just a little bit, and you can see that beautiful green turf course that we will get to for several races on this 11 race program. So everything kicks off at 12:30 p.m. We are fast and firm for these 11 races, as you can see. You sent that in, Stan. Very delightful. I like that word, delightful. And that's just what it is today here at Laurel Park. All right, you ready for some rapid-fire handicapping? We have 11 races to get to, so we're going to try to give you as much info as we possibly can in the next few minutes. Race one kicks us off, as does the Super High Five that carries on throughout the afternoon. 55-12, this is an amateur race if you are unfamiliar with the riders' names, but you still took a stab at the Super High Five. Again, the Pick Five starts in here too, a mandatory payout in the early Pick Five.
And a nice carryover in that Super High Five, a little over 5,500 for the Super High Five carryover for race one, has that low 15% takeout. And here's my ticket. I'm going to use the four, Get Rid Of, from the Robert Vukolic stable aboard. I'll go four over the 2.5, over 2.357, with the 2.3567 for the bottom two spots. An affordable $36 play. Nice carryover, a little over 5,500 for the Super High Five here in the opener. It's the amateurs. We're on the all-along turf course, and we have the complete names here of the amateurs in the program, and a challenging race here with that carryover for the opener.
It really is. I prefer the 8 Bourbon and Beer along with Lock Up the Bourbon. That's going to be my early daily double. I wonder why I've got bourbon on the mind. We have the 8 Bourbon and Beer, though, is who I opt for. 4-trainer Robbie Bales. This horse is by Pioneer of the Nile, out of a mare who won going long on the turf. She actually received her best buyer speed figure in 73. So no other foals have tried the turf, but this gelding has the pedigree to at least like a longer distance and perhaps like the turf.
Yeah, the dam, she made almost $130,000. Robbie Bales, a good trainer around here for a long time. First name here, it's Rebecca LeBerry. Here on the for the amateurs in the opener. I'm going to go with Rachel Keithen for trainer Robert Vukolic. My top pick here is the second time starter for this 3-year-old son of Admiral Alex. A decent debut against Maiden 10, going three quarters, made up some ground. That day came rallying between horses, a good third. Now we're stretching out two turns on the turf. This horse bred by Vincent Brichelli, who works with Vukolic. So he's a very good teacher of riders. So that's kind of my angle here. I'm thinking maybe he'll give this amateur rider Keithen some tips on, you know, how he used to win on Ruffian and stuff. So I'll go with the 4, Get Rid Of, on top.
Okay, I'll look at the 6 Big Platinum a little bit here for trainer Wayne Potts. I know you use this horse in your Super High Five ticket. I just think he's going to be a little bit closer to the pace on the stretch out and distance from 7.5. Was really well backed by the public last time out at 80 cents to the dollar. Hopefully we get a better price today. Usually speed is dangerous in these types of races. We get to the second race on the card to kick off the early Pick 4-7 furlongs onto the main track for this non-winners a 2-lifetime condition. And while Stan, I go to the 6 Lock Up the Bourbon, and this horse is only 1 for 18. I don't have a very strong feel for the Lock Up the Bourbon, but I do like the fact that she stretches out to this distance, and she has speed, so I'm hoping that she could maybe have the tactical advantage.
And she's won at this distance before. I use her in the mix. Yomar Ortiz, nice long shot winner on yesterday's card. I like the kind of the change up in running style that we saw from Lock Up the Bourbon last time, where the horse kind of came off the pace and had a good finish. And some of her earlier races, she'll be in front and then tie her. So at this 7-furlong distance, I hope they try to get her to settle and rate and have something there for the end. That's why I go with the 5 Fancy Outflanker on top. It looks like she's going to love the stretch out to 7 furlongs here. You get the apprentice Darius Thorpe aboard for Jana Fisher the third. A good fast closing second last out was a wide coming around the stretch, and a good second just got beat a neck in the slop going 5.5. So Fancy Outflanker can get the same kind of setup and trip today. I think she'll love the 7 furlongs.
All right, we both kind of like this 7 Kilt Chaser, and she does come out of 2 relatively easy races, a maiden 5,000 at Timonium and then coming back to face winners at Charlestown. But I like her running style at this distance. She just looks like she should be able to suit the race flow and then maybe becoming sitting maybe that stalking trip here at 7 furlongs.
Yeah, should be dead fit for this race coming off those 2 3-turn races, cutting back to this the 1-turn 7 furlong. So I think she'll get a piece of it. You get Victor Carrasco with a huge day yesterday. He's one of our top riders here. So nice 4-to-1 price there on the 7.
Okay, that is race 2. As we move right along to the 3rd, we head out to the Dahlia at a mile and a 16th. And we did have kind of a late scratch in the 11 Hoosier Girl, who I liked a little bit. But I still stick to the 13 Giovanna Blues for trainer Michael Dickinson. And this horse, she obviously ran very, very well first time out behind On Leave. On Leave, a very nice horse who went on to win the Grade 2 Sands Point a couple starts later after Saratoga. So you go back, she subpar performance over a good going at Saratoga. But her last race was actually quite good. I went back and watched the replay, and there was a loose horse in that race. And unfortunately, the rider, Amiciel Jaramillo, had to go extremely wide in that final turn. And she was just being a little over a length. So I think that trip really, really compromised her. The only negative thing is Michael Dickinson, his horses, especially at Laurel, they are very well backed by the public.
Yeah, so most likely be one of the favorites. I think the horse to beat, a deserved favored. Sharp effort last time at Park. So we know this horse will be dead fit and a factor to be reckoned with late. So I use her 13. She'll be running late. I'm going to go with the first-time starter from the Arnaud Delacour barn. This is a well-bred 3-year-old filly by Giants Causeway. They paid $310,000 for her. As a 2-year-old, she's out of a Mr. Greeley mare. Arnaud Delacour, 21% with his debut runners with a nice positive ROI. You see a whole series of nice works at Delaware and up there at Fair Hill, a few on the synthetic here in preparation for the debut. I like Giants Causeway, but most likely I'm going with the barn here, who's been firing at a pretty high rate with first-time starters.
Yeah, they do well really anywhere, whether it's dirt, turf, and anywhere in between. The mare, she made a significant amount of money in the second dam, actually, was a 2-time winner going long on the dirt. The mare made about $218,000 in Europe, so there is some very nice pedigree there on the top side and on the bottom side as well. I will use her. I'll also throw in the 12 Anissa here. However, she does look like one that could be a touch pace dependent, and my main concern is, will she get that pace today? It doesn't look like it unless one of these first time starters pops up with speed.
Yeah, she's always right there. Hot connections here. Victor Carrasco, Hammy Smith had a nice day yesterday as well. 3 straight seconds at this level. She'll be right there again, just like you said. She needs kind of a setup and a good trip to be right there. She's a beaten favorite last time. Just needs to kind of get over that hump and get the win.
Okay, that is the 3rd race on the card. The 4th, a nice first level allowance going 6 furlongs onto the main track. And most recently we did see If I Was a Boy and She Rolls. They paired up against each other last time out against Allowance Company. And I really liked If I Was a Boy last time out. But I'm starting to get the vibe from her that really everything needs to go her way in order for her to win. And that was kind of the case when she broke her maiden. She came back to run well behind Street Cruiser. She ran well at Pimlico. I was really basing my opinion off of her performance at Pimlico because it looked like she didn't like to be down on the inside. She's a horse that kind of wants to be out in the clear on her own. Can she get a trip like that today? She's second off the layoff. She should be tough.
Yeah, I've liked this filly for a while. We both liked her for a while, and I agree with you. She does need a little bit of a setup. She broke from the two hole last time. Maybe she can get a more of an outside stalking trip today, which I think she does like best. So maybe she can get that trip today with Jevion Toledo aboard. She's only been off the board once in eight starts, so she's very consistent. I thought she looked good in that comeback race last time and could very well improve here. Toledo stays aboard, so I'm going to use her on top today. I'm predicting the Super High Five carryover will carry to this race here because race two, we don't have it. Races one and three, they might not play it as aggressively as they will here in this race four here with seven horses, and we have a nice carryover. So keep your eye maybe out for that in race four.
Yes, once it gets to these smaller fields on the dirt, they really do hammer that particular bet. So keep your eyes out for that. I went to the two Hissy Fit here, thinking that she would be the speed of the speed last time out. She was a little bit run off her feet behind the speed of Scuba Sue, who I'm familiar with running down in South Florida. She just is an extremely fast filly. So she was caught a little bit off guard at Monmouth last time out, but I like the protect move for Hugh McMahon, protecting her right back in this A other than condition, and Hugh McMahon just having an outstanding fall meet so far at Laurel.
Absolutely. Yeah. A hot barn, hot jockey, Victor Carrasco, and 13 starts. This filly's been in the money 10 times with seven wins, so she knows how to find a winner's circle. She'll be forwardly placed from the inside. Carrasco might find himself on the lead. I respect all that. I use her second, I think, the main horse for if I was a boy to beat.
And even She Rolls, a horse that comes out of the same race as If I Was a Boy last time out. I actually thought She Rolls did the majority of the dirty work, kind of dueling on the inside. So now with an outside post, last time out she drew the rail. Now with an outside post, she has more options. And I think she prefers to perhaps being in that stalking trip or pressing trip, which she might be able to turn the tables on If I Was a Boy in that sense.
Yeah, good point. Her last win was exactly that kind of trip last July, that stalking trip. So much better post today with Fergal Lynch aboard. Nice 3-1 price. So I use her in the mix. Nice allowance race here in race four.
All right, race five, we head out to the Dahlia at 5.5 furlong for the starter, $7,500 condition. Is this where your best bet of the day comes in?
It is, yeah.
There we go.
And you agree with me. I like it. Maybe a key horse for that early pick five. We hit the early pick five and then parlay it back into that late pick five with that nice carryover.
Get some spending money with that $19,000 carryover today.
Exactly, yeah. Lady of Moray, a sharp winner last out, going 5.5 furlongs. On the turf, same condition, 7,500 starter. Trevor McCarthy aboard that day. Carrasco gets back aboard today. Carrasco's aboard two back when she was a 10-length winner in the dirt. She's very fast, turf or dirt. I like the barn a lot, Holly Robinson. She'll use that speed breaking from the two-hole, I think, to go right to the front and play catch me if you can today.
I do think she's going to be the fastest early, and I agree. The catch me if you can, hopefully going wire to wire. And not only that, same, we saw Miss Eileen, a horse in that field last time out. She came back to win a starter optional claimer on Friday in very impressive fashion under Jose Betancourt. She was very fast. So she actually outsprinted Lady of Moray last time out. But I can see Lady of Moray maybe dictating here today. Other than her, you and I both agree with that. We both kind of like the 8 Poochie for the exacta purposes. And you look at her race two starts back at Delaware. Maybe she didn't like that good going a little bit too much and maybe a little bit short off of the layoff, but she came back with a very impressive victory last time out at the Meadowlands.
Yeah, and had to break from the one hole and rallied for a nice win that day by 4 lengths going away at the end. So this is her third race back after having September off. Doug Nunn, he ships in here with some winners, brings his rider Garcia down here. So she should have a nice trouble-free trip stalking from the outside here today.
And the biggest question is, what are we going to see from Hug a Tree today? Because she was good enough to beat A Other Than Company. They stepped her up to 2 Other Than Company. And overall, I thought it was a good performance. She's been putting in good performances, just not quite getting there. However, Vilsom, I mean, you look at a horse who's been facing Stakes Company, right. Graded Stakes Company. So maybe she's just meeting a more manageable field today.
Yeah, she's well spotted. She's a stalker, a closer type filly, so she should get clear run from the outside. Francois did a nice job with her, but we're getting the journeyman rider today for his voice, and she's on a roll. So yeah, sometimes that can wake a horse up a little bit. J.W. Delosier's done a nice job with this 5-year-old mare for a while, so she always gets a piece of it. Good stats here at Laurel Park, and I'll throw her into the mix today.
That is races 1 through 5. That is a wrap of the early pick 5. We are going to take a quick break. Stan has a pick 6 ticket for you. I have a late pick 5 ticket for you. Carryovers galore right after this. Bet like no other. That's coming up. Breeders' Cup is quickly coming up as well. We look at race 6 on the card. We have a carryover 2360. Stan, let's take a look at your ticket.
All right, I'm going to spread here in the first leg. I'll go 6 deep here in race 6 to kick off the rainbow pick 6. I think this nickel 3 life going a mile is wide open. So a spread race in race 6. And I'm just going 3 deep in race 7 and then 2 deep for the last 4 legs, 8, 9, 10, 11. I'll just go 2 deep in each of those races. So I have strong opinions in the later part of the card, but this opener here, race 6 to kick off the pick 6, I think a wide open race. But I like my ticket, a $57.60 play. Nice carryover, a little over $2,300 for today's pick 6. So expecting a live pull here. Let's see if we can get live in the opener.
Okay, I'm going to the 7 Girovit here for trainer Benny Feliciano. I don't think this horse does his best running on a track with much moisture in it, and that has been the case. Also with a turf race kind of thrown in the mix there most recently. So getting back to a dry main track, and not to mention this horse had considerable trouble last time out and faced the likes of Resurgence, who was a major class dropper. So I will go back to Girovit, and Stan, you go to the inside to the number 2, Hey Willie.
I respect the 7. I'll use the 7 in the exact. I'll throw the 2 on top here. Class dropper for Ferris Allen, Alex Centron aboard. This 3-year-old is a 3-time winner at this 1-mile distance. All 3 of those wins came here at Laurel Park. His last race, it was on one of those good sealed tracks. He gets a fast track today and a class drop. Breaking from the inside doesn't bother me at all with this 1-mile distance here. They'll have plenty of time to sort themselves out down the backstretch. He's had a couple coast-to-coast wins here, if there's nothing up front early on, if there's a slow early pace, we could see the 2, Hey Willie, take advantage of that and go right to the front.
We very well could. That is a spread race for you there in the pick 6, Stan. Let's talk about the late pick 5 here as we turn our attention to the 7th race on the card, a $35,000 claiming condition on the All Along at 5.5 furlongs. I took a stab at the ticket. You and I are going to put our heads together and try to take this down today. We can't let the money go everywhere else. We need to keep this in our pockets, right, Stan? We look at the late pick 5 ticket. It's going to be $60, 4 by 2 by 1 by 2, 4, 5 by 3. So spreading in race 10, but going to be singling on Enough is Enough, a recent claim for trainer Mary Epler. You and I both like the horse, so that is going to be the single of the day. We get to the 7th though, and a very wide open $35,000 claimer. I went with a shot here in the 8 Mona Vista Crossing. I do think that this 3-year-old filly has to maybe take a little bit of a step up in order to beat the rest of the field, but she I think has found her niche sprinting on the turf, and she also has shown kind of a multi-dimensional type of running style where she could stalk or go to the lead.
Exactly, yeah, the win 2 back when she was making her turf debut, she had one of those nice stalking trips, and then her most recent race, which was a tough allowance race, I think a little tougher than this race today. She's in for a tag here today, but she had to break from the inside on a soft, good turf and had her hand force, went to the front, still a good third, just beating a neck in a tough allowance race. So much better outside post today. Kevin Gomez stays aboard. Ollie Figgins with a nice debut winner in the finale yesterday. So the barn's going well, and we both have a nice 6-to-1 shot on top here to kick off the late pick 5. So we agree in this leg.
We do. And honestly, if you're looking at this race, I think the The horse to beat in here is the class dropper, the 6 Seaside Schiller for trainer Michael Matz, coming out of 2 other than Allowance Company. But she does sit on 2 questionable performances. We have really not seen the same filly that we saw earlier in her career, so I will use her protectively. Stan, you give a little bit of a shot to the 10 Sippy Cup, who was a big shot winner last time out at 37-1.
Yeah, big price last time. We won't get quite that big a price, but still a nice 8-1 price with my main long shot rider, Yomar Ortiz, aboard for my main long shot trainer, Charlie L. Frock. So this 3-4-year-old filly likes the turf to a win and a second 4 starts on the grass. I think that starter allowance last out, a comparable level to this level today. Ortiz will get a nice outside a run here. The horse has enough early speed to put herself into good condition. So I think a live 8-1 shot.
Okay, looks like we kind of agree there. In the first leg of the late pick 5, we get to the 8th race here on the Dahlia at 5.5 furlongs. And we have one short price favorite in here, the Morning Line favorite in the 7, Coastal Sea, this 3-year-old filly going against Elders today. And I think we have a video spotlight replay of her allowance win. This was 2 starts back in July, the 24th of July, and she was very impressive that day. She ran a hole in the wind. She was extremely impressive in her first start, too, when she broke her maiden at first asking, and she can really just work out her own trip. She closes from off the pace. I know the pace was a little bit quicker when she did win the allowance and it came back to her, but that really wasn't the case when she went against maiden special weight company, and no harm in trying her against stakes company, shipping her up to Belmont last time out. This is probably the right spot for her, but it's still a tough race.
It's a tough race, but that was a freaky good win there. Elusive Joni, who she beat in that race, would come back to win. And I thought a very respectable outing in that stake last out. Only got beat 3 lengths to some tough customers up there at Belmont. Angel Cruz, what a meet he's having. Nice, got his first Maryland Million win yesterday, and a Grade 1 winner a few weeks back at Keeneland. So he'll get, you know, that win that we just showed there, that was her navigating a trip, coming from off the pace, breaking from the 3-hole, breaking from the 7 post today. She should get a dream trip, closing hopefully in the clear. So I like her 5-2 price here. Timmy Keefe almost with a big win at a big price yesterday. In the Maryland Million Nursery. I hope he can get the money here today.
All right, the 8 Catching Firefly is the horse I'm going to try to beat her with Arno Delacour. They keep her at a higher level even after a very strange performance last time out. She had very weird action coming down the lane, and it looked like the rider, Daniel Centeno, just kind of protected her, wrapped up on her, and just proceeded from there. Maybe she wasn't handling the Parks turf that day, but she sure should like the Laurel turf course here. So I'm going to go back to her just thinking that maybe there was a bit of a mishap after that long layoff, but Arno Delacour protecting her. And of course, we have the 11 Seeking Paradise, a 2-time winner on the turf coming out of Allowance Company. If she does duplicate her performance last time out, or even the start prior where she did get into a considerable amount of trouble, she should be very tough too.
Yeah, Caramano should be able to get a nice trip on her. Coming out of a couple of tough races, she's posted an 80-plus buyer speed figure in her last 5 starts. So I think if she doesn't get caught too wide, she'll be very tough.
All right, that is race 8. The 9th race, we'll move right along to 1/16 on the main track for the starter optional claiming event. And this is where my single and a horse that you like, not necessarily your single, but it comes into play. And that is the 4 Enough is Enough. I think this is a very, very savvy claim for trainer Mary Epler. The biggest thing about this horse that I was questioning was he was a runaway winner when he broke his maiden on the main track at Tampa, and they never tried him back on the dirt. So why not? First off, the claim, I love this move here.
Yeah, Mary Epler, our leading trainer here, she's having a heck of a fall. That was, I think, a nice claim here by Patio Prado. Sharp maiden win at Tampa. He's in good form. We know he's in good form now off that turf win. So I think could be a very nice claim, and we're getting a nice 9-2 price here. You're single. I have the horse on top. We're all over this pick 5.
And we are. The 3 Louis the Great. First off, the claim for Kieran McGee. I like the protect move here. First off, the claim for the move up here in for that $14,000 tag, but facing a tougher condition, should be able to show a little bit of speed, Stan, and you kind of give a little bit of a tip of the hat to the 7 Percy in here.
Yeah, this horse, 3-year-old by Straight Sense, 1-2 in a row for Kelly Rubley, a good barn. Eric Rodriguez, we know he ride well around here, so horse showed speed in the win last out. The win 2 back came from off the pace, so looks like the 7 Percy going in the right direction at 10-1. Nice price today.
Okay, we get to our feature race of the day, a 3 other than allowance optional claimer on the All Along at 5.5 furlongs. And we'll start the conversation off with the number 1 Elusive Joni. And this is a horse that you just mentioned going against Coastal Sea a few starts back. But this was her victory here at Laurel on September 11th against 2 other than company. She would come back to stretch out in distance to 7.5 furlongs over a yielding going at Delaware. That was a very, very tough race. But she just has kind of turned in, she keeps improving with each and every start with the exception of her last race. And Stan, she really can just work out her own trip from anywhere. She had a break from the rail post 2 times here at Laurel and then Delaware, and it doesn't faze her.
Yeah, she's and I can forgive her for the last effort up there at Delaware. That was on a soft yielding turf course, so just really draw a line through that race and you'll see the 2 sharp wins. We just saw one there. The 1 hole doesn't bother her at all. Kevin Gomez, he's lost a bug now, but I think he's going to be just fine. He's on a roll. Finished his apprentice career as in the top 3 for bug riders, so I think he deserves maybe a nod for the Eclipse Award for the top 3 apprentice riders. So the jocks having a good meet. Gary Kapp having a very good meet. I respect her. I use her 3rd. I'll go with the Mac Robertson shipper on top, though, with Julian Pimentel. The 2, Manil. This horse has won 3 in a row up there in Minnesota, up there at Canterbury.
Minnesota.
But it looks like she likes the turf. She'll be 4ly placed, maybe on the lead here at 5-2.
She's very fast. She might be able to dictate in here. I went with a little bit of a shot with the 3, Candida H, for trainer Mike Trombetta. And she's always put in really strong performances. I mean, you look at her track record, she's 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 1st, 2nd, 3rd. So she's a very consistent type, and she tries every time. The only time that she did try sprinting on the turf, it was off of an April to November layoff, and that was over a good going. So you could argue that maybe she didn't like the course that day, but still closed from off of it at a nice price behind Proven Turf Sprinters and Forest Funds and 2 Wonders, especially Forest Funds. She's a pretty decent turf sprinter. So I'm going to go back to her just shopping for a little bit of a price here. Stan, it looks like you and I are all over the map. The 5, Pretty Perfection, though, I think is one you have to use. She faced Miss Ella, who is a stakes winner in the Smart and Fancy last time out, and maybe she just was a little bit short coming off that year layoff.
I respect the connections here. Kelly Breen shipping into town. He'll be all dressed up, looking dapper. Gets Fergal Lynch. This horse is going to have to improve 2nd off the long layoff. 2nd time in the Kelly Breen barn. He'll have to do a little bit better than that last out. But that was a tough stake race up there at Saratoga. The place horse came back to win. Mm-hmm. So it may be a little class relief here. Nice price on that one. I'll throw the 8 in there at 8-1 from the Tony Pecoraro barn. Eric Rodriguez aboard. This 3-year-old filly, last time we saw her sprinting on the turf was here at Laurel back in early July. A nice upper level allowance race that day, and she went right to the front and kept on going, beat a nice field. And I remember talking to Pecoraro after that race because she went off, 3-1 that day. Mm-hmm. And Pecoraro, I don't think I picked her on top, and Pecoraro was kind of giving me some grief, said, make sure you go and look up her breeding a little bit more. There's some nice turf pedigree there. And so he really likes this filly on the turf. She gets back on the turf today at a nice price.
I think you just like saying Tony Pecoraro. You always really enunciate it. We get to the 11th and final race on the card on the Dahlia at 5.5 furlongs. And I land on the 4, Uncle Tito, for trainer Ann Merriman, taking a bit of a drop in class, in my opinion. You get a horse who did face, or he dropped in class last time out, and he did experience some trouble. That was the first time dropping in for the tag. He previously was going against allowance company, so I'm thinking with perhaps an unencumbered trip, he could have a better result. Stan, you land on the 12 to the way outside, Joe Tess. I use this horse in my late pick 5. I'm going to be using the 3, 4, and the 12. I think the 12 is going to be dangerous.
Yeah, Joe Tess has early speed. Angel Rodriguez aboard for Hugh McMahon. Barn's going well. Last time Joe Tess was on the turf was in a stake at Pimlico. Tough race that day. Last time we saw him on the turf, here at Laurel was going short 15,000, opened 15,000 back in April, was a good second to Came Back from the Alan Goldberg barn. Mm-hmm. Came Back would come back to win. So I think Joe Tess, with his running style, very dangerous from the outside.
All right, and the three Silent Tail, you and I both give the nod to as well. If nobody goes with Silent Tail, just like they didn't last time out, he could easily wire the field under Al Cortez back aboard the regular rider there for Silent Tail. That is about it for you and I here. We have to give a little bit of time. Dave Rodman will be up shortly with those scratches and changes, but thank you once again for joining us here on Today at the Races. We have 11 races on tap. We have $19,000 in that carryover in the late pick five, carryover in the super high five and the pick six, so there's no excuse not to join us this afternoon. Best of luck.